sur Carmel. Audrey, Linda, met 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 sur Carmel. Feed our people with the rod of knock off the heritage. Audrey, solitary in the wood, in the midst of Carmel. Who dwell in the midst of Carmel? Who dwell in the midst of Carmel? Who dwell in the midst of Carmel? Who dwell in the midst of Carmel?
We are meditating from the book of Malachi for the last couple of weeks, the last 4 or 5 weeks. Great King, chapter 1. You are the messenger of the Lord, chapter 2. Servant of God, angel of God, chapter 3. For the last 3 weeks, we are meditating from chapter 1. In verse 1, the duty of the servant of God is to make the way for the Lord. Everybody has got a problem. Everybody needs comfort and consolation. The earth is in darkness, and the people are in utter darkness. So as servants of God, we have to speak to the people. We have to prophesy. We speak for God. We tell them, your warfare is over. Your battle is over. God will bless you. The glory of the Lord shall be seen upon you. You prepare the way for the Lord. They'll ask a question, what shall I do to prepare the way for the Lord? It's very simple. Tell them. All high places should be brought low. All the valleys should be filled. Crooked things make straight. And the hard ones make it smooth. The Lord will come. The Lord will bless you. Console them. Comfort them. That's the duty of an angel of God. And in verses 2 and 3, we meditated. As the angel of the Lord, we must be holy before Him. In these last days, we all are the angels of God. We all must be holy. There are 2 different types of angels in the Bible. Holy angels, unholy angels, or fallen angels. They all are angels. It's a big question whether we are holy angels or fallen angels. There is no demilitarized zone. You can't say, I am not holy, I am not unholy. I am not holy. It doesn't mean I am unholy. Please listen. There is no demilitarized zone. Either you are holy or naturally you are unholy. There is nothing in between. There is nothing in between. I am neither holy nor unholy. No, there is no stand like this. Even an ordinary earthen pot that is used to take the defiled things without the camp to be broken. Even that earthen pot must be whole, as holy as a golden vessel that can be taken the propitiation blood into the holies, into the holy of holies. There is no separate holiness in the New Testament. In some churches, they follow two sets of holiness, one for the inner circle, a priesthood, or another type of holiness in the outer circle for the congregation, for the laity. There is no Bible sanction for that. There's no two different standards. In the New Testament, you and I are going to be with the Lord in heaven. It is not that you would be in Jerusalem, I will be in Zion. My dear brother, my dear sister, Paul says, with you, we will be where Jesus is. We will be with Jesus. We will be with Jesus. We will be with him on Mount Zion. My dear brother, my dear sister, we all must be holy unto the Lord. Not only the part in the sanctuary, even part in Jerusalem and Judah must be holy. We all are angels of God. We all must be holy. And in our church, we know what we mean by holiness. Separated from, set apart, sanctified unto God's purpose. So this holy life is very, very essential. And from verses 3 and 4, the third point we consider, we must be able to make an offering that is pleasant unto the Lord. When our life is holy, our service will be pleasant unto the Lord. Let it be acceptable to Him. When we say let it be acceptable to Him, our life from head to toe, it is acceptable to Him. It's not a question whether it's acceptable to the society or not. Whether it is pleasing to our Lord, whether we are God pleasers. Whether we want to please God. My dear brother, my dear sister. In Tamil Bible, it's very clear. There are five things which pleases us, we want to please that. One is, we want to please ourselves. That period. And the second one, we want to have the pleasure of pleasure. We want to have the pleasure of pleasure. At times we have the pressure to have pleasure. At times we have the pressure to have pleasure. Sugaboga period. Sugaboga period. One day a boy asked me, he was telling me up to my face, my head was spinning. I thought that I would fall down. All along it's a joy to work. I cannot imagine how somebody would. Maybe working hard would be difficult. What's that he wants to do? They love pleasure. Pleasure to have pleasure. Sukha boha priya. I cannot even imagine that in a remote way. How can I be without doing anything? If somebody is there without doing anything, he's dead. That's why some people are dead in iniquities and sin. They are dead. We want to be alive, we should be doing something and we should find pleasure in it. My dear brother, my dear sister. So some people are tharpiriya, some people are sugaboha priya, some people always try to please others. Manishya priya. They try to please others. Whatever they do, what my friends will say, what my neighbors will say. If I dress like this, what will they say in college? I want a peer acceptance. Peer acceptance means my friends must accept. How long you want to live for others? I have studied in college. I was not saved. I was after the fashions of the world. Even when I was after the fashions of the world, I wanted to be a trendsetter, and I have been mocked at for that. I want to dress the way that I wanted to dress. I didn't mind what others would say about it. I praise God for that propensity. When I got saved, it's easier for me. I wanted to dress how the Lord would like me to dress. How the Lord would like me to dress. During my college days, it was in the late 60s and the early 70s, the skin tight pants were the fashion. And I cannot remove my pants, only my mother has helped me to strip it out. Today I am ashamed of it. And in 71 or something, at the time, the bells were coming in. I was the earliest one to have bells. It's about 24 inches. Probably Brother Dell may remember it. So one side itself will be 12 inches. And when we stand even without shoes, our feet should not be seen. We are so holy. Even when we stand without shoes, our feet should not be seen. I'm sorry. Even when we stand without shoes, our feet should not be seen. Probably that, if that continued, it would help our Narendra Modi's program, Clean India campaign. Even when we walk, we can clean the streets. That is my dress style when I got saved in 72. The first thing, I threw that pants away. Nobody was wearing a normal pants at that time. I don't say this is right or wrong, but I decided I want to dress in a way that is acceptable to the Lord. That is acceptable to the Lord. I was 21 years old. Probably at that time in my college, I was the only one who was wearing a normal pants. I continue. Fashions change. I continue, I love to continue. Never I have been out of place after that. So don't try to please others. If it is okay between you and God, it's okay. It's between okay between you and God, it's okay. Okay, some people, they want to please others. Some people want to have only the pleasure of money. They are willing to do anything and everything for money. They're willing to do, their very lifestyle, their very commitment is for money. There was a very good guitarist. He was playing in a church. And he was a chief musician in that church. And he was doing that, he was part of that church. And the pastor was also helping that musician in many great ways. Not as a salary, But he was helping him in many great ways. Another new ministry came as blessing from heaven. They promised, we pay 2,000 rupees or 2,500 rupees every Sunday. It's not the doctrine, it is not his church commitment, nothing else. When somebody was willing to pay 2,000 rupees just playing ding ding ding, his music was very good. He was willing to leave his church, he was willing to leave his pastor. I don't say you should not quit a church or anything. For some people, their only commitment is money. I'm really shocked. I know that brother very much. I'm shocked. Somebody was going to a particular church. They got fellowship with the church. This ministry said, oh, you are playing keyboard. We'll give this big amount every week. You come and play keyboard. They immediately forsook their church. Somebody is paying money. My dear brother, my dear sister, I ask a simple question. Ask a simple question. I don't hurt anybody, but it's a question I'm compelled to ask. If somebody is throwing some bread crumbs and something is jumping to it, is there any difference in this? Is our spiritual commitment only based on money? Suppose somebody working in a corporation, it's not a spiritual commitment, he's working in that job, and somebody is paying more, they skip. In these days it's very common. Earlier even that was not so. So now it has become a job for many people. I praise God, probably our church is the only one church different in that. Praise God for our top brand musicians. So their only living is for money. So it's a sugabhoga priyar, tarpriyar, panapriyar, manisha priyar, and there's one fifth category, deva priyar. Deva priyar. My dear brother, my dear sister, let our life be a pleasant offering to the Lord. Let our life be pleasant offering to the Lord. God should accept it. Even a few days back, I was telling another servants of God. There were two servants of God with me. So Anand was also there. I said, because I'm speaking this to me. Vain, 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 all is vain. Ministry is also vain. If my life is not pleasant to the Lord. If my life is not pleasant to the Lord, preaching is vain. I should be doing for one of these three or four areas. For money's sake. Or pleasing others. Or for my self-pleasure. Oh, he's a very good preacher. It's a vain. Unless my life is acceptable by the Lord. Vain, vain, vain. All things are vain under the sun. Even ministry would become vain. My dear brother, my dear sister. So last week we also continued, I think, to the fourth point, verses 5, 6 and 7. Mete out God's righteousness. That's what he expects from us. Lead a life that metes out God's righteousness in our life. God's stand. When you mix our relationship with our wives, our husbands, our children, our servants, in our work spot, in a ministry, in the church, what is right for God is right for me. So the fourth point last week we considered, mete out God's righteousness. You are a servant of God. In one place Paul writes, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, however we should prove that we are servants of God. We are servants of God. Whether they like us or dislike us, it should be for that one reason: you are meeting out God's righteousness. Whether they receive us or reject us, whether they accept us or not, it should be for one reason: that you are meeting out the righteousness of God. My dear brother, my dear sister, as the time permits, I try to conclude this message before we commence our fasting prayer tomorrow. And God willing, after our fasting prayers are over, in the month of December, we go to Malachi chapter 4. Now please go with me to verse 8. Malachi chapter 3, verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offering. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven, and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. See the blessings. Verse 11. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. Neither shall your wine cause to have fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. Verse 12. The blessings continue. And all nations shall call you blessed, for you shall be a delightsome land, a delightsome person, saith the Lord of hosts. My dear brother, my dear sister, in this morning I'm not taking a detailed study on tithes and offerings. And I remember there was a message I preached earlier, Kartharudaiya Pandaga Salai, the Lord's storehouse. In that I have given a detailed study about tithes and offerings. However, briefly I tell you, tithes and offering is not under the law. Tithes and offering was a spiritual practice that was even before the law was given. Historically speaking, this practice was even before Judaistic religion. It is in many other communities. Even they were giving, it was a practice to give their tithes to their rulers. From that only we get our tax system. So this is the practice to honor the Lord, to acknowledge Him as He is their King. The practice of giving one-tenth of all their income, all their blessings to the Lord, to acknowledge His leadership, His rulership. This is the practice. See, we are this citizens of this country. We are proud to pay our taxes. Taxpayers are not punishment. They are running this country. My dear brother, my dear sister, when I came to the ministry, the first thing, I voluntarily started paying the tax. I am paying the tax. As a citizen of this country, I am proud that I pay tax. This is accepting our government. So in those days, in all their income, the kings were there protecting them, the kings were doing every civil need for those people. So acknowledging their leadership, their rulership, these people were giving a part to their king. That's a relationship between the king and the citizens. It's a very cordial relationship. So when Abraham accepted Melchizedek the king, Abraham was giving his tithes to the king in all his proceeds. And who is this Melchizedek? There are a lot of discussions, and mostly it is believed. I also did the calculation and I got a reason to believe that Melchizedek was mostly, it could be Shem, the son of Noah. Because when Abraham was of that age, Shem was alive. Shem was Noah's son. So Abraham and all were in the tribe of Shem. On that day, the patriarch of that tribe was Shem. So Abraham might have paid the tithe to Shem. My dear brother, my dear sister, that must have been a practice. Isaac must have done that. Jacob makes it very specific to establish his acknowledgement of God as his king, his ruler. He's a pilgrim. He doesn't have a country. He declared, I am a pilgrim. Even when he was talking to Pharaoh, he said, I am a pilgrim. A sojourner. They don't have a nation, they don't have a country. But he wanted to continue that practice. And he said, Lord, I will pay tithes to you. So paying tithes was a practice of any good citizen. There are tax evaders. Like that, there are tithe evaders. They find many ways to evade tax. Even celebrities, there is a prosecution against them because they evaded tax. Many celebrities. So the mentality of people is to evade tax. So the mentality of some people is to evade paying tithes. That's only a mentality. They don't want. There are many chartered accountants to help us how to we can evade tax paying. My dear brother, my dear sister, I was telling our accountant, I said that you make a clean account, I am proud to pay tithe. I am proud to pay my tax. My dear brother, my dear sister, when they become slaves in Egypt, they didn't have any income, they were not paying any tithes. The laws given in the wilderness, they are not new laws. Commit not adultery is not a new law. Rob not is not a new law. This has been a practice. What has been a practice was made into a structured law. We can't say this is only for the New Testament, this is only for the Old Testament, nothing like that. So this has been a practice. My dear brother, my dear sister, as we evade tax, the Malachi says, in the book of Malachi, the Lord says, it is deceiving God. What we call the tax evaders today. So this government will put them into jail. What will they do, the tax evader? They'll pull all their money. They put sanctions against them. They make sure that they pay all the amounts. Probably to some time, we can cheat some people. We can cheat our government. But always we cannot cheat our government. Even if somebody is too clever to cheat the state, I mean Indian government or the worldly government, we cannot cheat God's government. So one day God's government will take action if we are tithe evaders. That's what we read here. I will curse this, I will curse that. Today we are taken and put in the box. On that, but God's kingdom, God will know how to punish us. God knows how to bless us. God knows how to punish us. My dear brother, my dear sister, it is only our mental attitude towards a God system. It is in the New Testament, it's not in the New Testament. There's no argument like that. It was before the law, it is after the law. And we accept God's reign and the best practices. You give your tithes and offerings to the pastor whom the Lord has given you to lead you. Okay, can't I just share it? It's only for the ministry. I can share it certain for evangelistic work, certain amount for the missionary work, certain amount for a magazine. Can't I distribute it as I want? It's a very simple question. Please listen. The moment you decide to distribute as you want, what happens? You become the lord of that money. Because you take decisions on it. So one day you think that I will send this money to this mission. You heard something bad about that mission. Tomorrow you take a decision. No, I don't want to send this money to that mission. I will send this money to this mission. Why should I send this money here? I will send it here. And you wanted to, some poor pastor you thought, and you are going to give this money to him. You come to know about it. Oh, his moral life is bad. I don't want to give to him. So every time you take your decisions on that expenditure or that account, and you become the Lord of your tithes. The Bible says the Lord is the Lord over your tithes. It's for you to know whether you fear the Lord or not. You are bringing it to the storehouse. My dear brother, my dear sister, but if you read a practice in the Old Testament, it helps us understand how we should do it. God wants to bless us. So you have got an income of 10,000 rupees and you are bringing 1,000 as tithes. 9,000 for you to spend. In 1,000 he has given as tithes. In the 9,000, it's your money, you can spend as you want. The Bible says, you take 900 rupees, a tithe of your money, 900 rupees, you use it for the levy, for the stranger to come with you to the house of prayer for Passover. Spend it for them, for your family, to come to church, to bring a servant of God, to help some ministry. Every good Christian is spending that money. They pay their tithes, and from their 9/10, they spend for their petrol. They spend for going for some ministry. Maybe 10 rupees for one magazine. Another 10 rupees for some missionary work. Or 100 rupees for missionary work. 50 rupees for missionary work. But there is a law of equality in a church. Maybe 100 people pay 1,000 rupees. It becomes a 1 lakh. That ministry needs are taken care of. That rent, that electricity, the people, those who are working there, and that pastors, the need of that ministry is taken care. 100 people pay 100 rupees. Whereas to a magazine or to missionary work, that is a global view. 1,000 people are sending 10 rupees, 100 rupees, their 10 lakh may be reached. My dear brother, my dear sister. So I don't want to get into a detailed study on tithing. If you want, you can get that message CD and you can listen to it. But briefly I say, it's not a question of Old Testament or New Testament. It is our acknowledgement of God. And we don't have right over that money. We have got right over the remaining 9/10. The remaining 9/10 belong to you. You spend as you want. You give to anybody as you want. You give to any ministry as you want. You have got a freedom to spend. My dear brother, my dear sister, otherwise it comes to a situation, you are throwing an amount on the pastor. As I use a crude expression, but to make it clear, throwing it into the ring. Anybody know that expression? Throwing it into the ring? In those days, some jugglers, some kutadi, he will stand in a ring and he will be dancing, an entertainer. He'll show some magics and all. People will stand around and watch. And after that, just they throw some amount into that ring for the damasha he has shown. You cannot throw some amount like that for the preaching pastor is doing into the ring and going out. The pastor is not a juggler or a magician or an entertainer or a soothsayer. He is a servant of God. We must be able to honor the Lord with your substance. There is a vast difference between charity and honoring the Lord with your substance. Okay, I'm not getting into the detail. But here the point is much more than that. My dear brother, my dear sister, the point is, deceive not. Don't deceive God. Don't deceive God. And the caption I have given is, maintain honesty before God. Maintain honesty before God. In the New Testament, if our righteousness is not more than the righteousness of the Pharisees, we cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus said, when he talks about the laws of Moses, Jesus said, don't give that up. Don't give that up. But add this also, your love, your mercy. Jesus never said give that up. They do all these things, you don't give it up. Your righteousness must be more. If they get a bunch of herbs, I put it easily in Tamil, ஒரு கீரை கொத்து கிடைக்குமா, they will count the leaves in that kira. I read in one book, they will read how many herbs. That's what Jesus said, vendayathilum enadhu kottamallilum, they count how many leaves in that kira, in that kottu. Then they will take 10 out of it, one-tenth out of it. That's what exactly Jesus said, vendayathilum kottamallilum enama sonna tamil. You bring tithes. They are very meticulous. Jesus laughed at him and said, your righteousness must be more than that. It is not ஒரு கீரைக்கட்டை கவுண்ட் பண்ணி எவ்வளோ இருக்குன்னு பார்த்து. Okay, my, why should I give it in take home, or net, or gross, or the salary given in the ration card, or salary that is given in the bank? Ration card one salary so that I can get all the other benefits. In the bank another salary so that I can get my loan sanctioned. Whom do we deceive? Then a big question, Pastor, on which salary I should take tithe? It is on the net or on the gross or my take home? Somebody came and told me, it was very pathetic. His take home salary is much less than his tithes. What to do? All loans. He is asking me, Pastor, how can I pay tithes? So what's your salary? Say 10,000 rupees. What's your take home pay? Salary 789 rupees. What happened? Diwali loan, co-op tax loan, house loan, everything you are enjoying. Everything you are enjoying. You are taking the money in advance. I said, simple proposition. The day that you have taken the loan, you must have paid the tithe. Then today you may not have a problem. Total, gross, net, take home. Don't break your head. Make life simple. That's what the first point. Make hard things smooth. Don't make simple things complicated. My dear brother, my dear, God wants to bless you. God wants to bless you. Jesus said, don't count all these kira and bring tithes. When you bring home your kottamalli, don't count how many kottamallis are there. 139 kottamallis. So 1314 kottamallis. Now how many kottamallis I should give as tithe? How many kottamallis? Come in, I must give as tithe. It is 1349. So 134.9. So this 9, can I make it 140? Or can I cut this one kottamalli into 9 parts? 10 parts? Jesus said, nonsense, rubbish. This is not expected of God. Have a joy in giving. It is honoring the Lord with your substance. We want to give something to the Lord, show that we love Him, we honor Him. You are bringing a wedding invitation. With that invitation, you bring a box of sweets just to show your love to your pastor. So when you are bringing your tithes and your offerings, it's a joy, it's a joyful occasion. It's not a punishment, it's not a pain, but that depends on our mentality. Whether we are proud in paying our tax, or we are tax evaders, we go to our chartered accountant, find all the ways how I can evade my tax, or just because I want to evade my tax, I say I get salary only, I don't want to say anything, you'll add something to it. What's it I want to do? It's my mind. My dear brother, my dear sister, here the question is, not only in tithes, in offerings, in any life situation, don't try to deceive God. Don't try to deceive God. God knows everything. He knows what's your salary. Say your salary is 50,000 rupees or 48,000 rupees. You write 4,500 rupees as your tithes. Will not God think that you are deceiving Him? Okay, 48,000 rupees your salary, you are giving 5,000 rupees as tithe. Doesn't God think that you are happy in giving to the Lord, to the ministry, to the church where you are blessed with the word of God? Just imagine, analyze. I know some people, it is the very same standard 1,000 rupees. And what will the Lord do? He will also make your salary the same standard 10,000 rupees. Or he makes sure your company will increase. He will make sure locusts will eat, cankerworms will eat, some accident, some sickness, some repair, something will eat that up. Something will eat that up. You just sit and calculate what all we evaded the Lord, in another way it would have been spent. It's not a question 4 rupees or 400 rupees or 4,000 rupees or 40,000 rupees. God doesn't need that money. But when it is 5 rupees, don't give 4 rupees. Don't deceive him. He asked a simple question. Peter asked a simple question. Is this the price? Is this the price that you sold your belongings? That belong to you. That belongs to you. Is this the price that you sold? Is it the really 1/10 of your income? Have you calculated this with a joy? Or you broke your head, net, grass? Think for a minute. It's a joy, it's a pleasure. You're giving it to the Lord. It's not to Peter. It's not to Robert. Peter may ask a question. Is this the rate in which you sold? Is this the 1/10 of your income? My dear brother, my dear sister, whether Ananias, Sapphira give or they don't give, God will establish his kingdom. The curse is only on the Ananias and Sapphira. God's kingdom doesn't suffer because of that. In every area, so you are standing and singing. The Bible says clearly, don't get offended, please. I want to help you. You are a servant of God. You are an angel of God. Either you are a holy angel or a fallen angel. No demilitarized zone. Or you are an angel who are honest before God, or you are an angel that tries to deceive God. The Bible says, I give a song in your mouth that you will not forget. And that song that you sing will testify against you on the day of judgment. நீ மறக்காத ஒரு பாடலை உன் வாயிலே நான் கொடுப்பேன், அது உனக்கு விரோதமாக சாட்சி சொல்லும். It will testify against you. You are standing before the Lord and singing, எல்லாம் இயேசுவே. And the Lord will laugh. நீ சொல்ற எல்லாம் இயேசுவேன். All to thee I surrender. Lord will say, really? Is it not a lie? You don't surrender anything to me. They put all jewels and sing, Ponnum Velliyum, God, Ellam Yesuve. God will laugh at it. It's a lie. It's a lie. Only once, by mistake, with the whole congregation, I sang twice or thrice. லட்சங்களுக்கு என்னை ஆசீர்வாதம் ஆக்கினீர். என்னப்பட்டு லட்சங்களுக்கு லட்சங்களை ரட்சிக்க பயன்படுத்தினீரே. In the presence of God with fear and trembling, I say it shocked me. Lord, I am lying in your presence. You have not yet used me for the salvation of lakhs. I thought within me, I saved one person. One person received Holy Spirit in my Sunday VBS. Now that person is preaching to lakhs. Okay, that also in my account. I was trying to type up. Then I said, no. Whenever I sing that part, anegarukku. I am not used for, to the best of my knowledge. Maybe directly. Father can sing that. Father can sing that. My dear brother, my dear sister. It's not that we voluntarily try to deceive God. God asks the question, what's your name? What's your name? My name is Esau. Oh, your voice sounds like Jacob. I am your eldest son, Esau. Jacob deceived his father, deceived his brother, deceived his parents-in-law, his father-in-law, his brothers-in-law. One day he had a personal encounter with God. Same question what Isaac asked, God asked, what's your name? 20 years back, when your father asked, what's your name? You said, Esau. Peter asked, is this the amount that you sold? Your pastor asked, is this your 1/10 of your income? You just written tithe. You gave an answer. One day, God Almighty asks, what's your name? What's your name? He struggles all through the night. He struggles. Bless me, bless me, bless me. I will not leave you unless you bless me. He said, what's your name? Bless me, Lord. What's your name? Jacob, supplanter, deceiver. God said, henceforth you are called Israel. You are an overcomer. You overcame with God. It's not that God can be defeated. In the presence of God, he defeated the devil. He defeated the devil with the strength of God. He accepted who he was. Many times we try to deceive God in different ways, not only in tithes and offerings. We have our own ideas of our lifestyle. My dear brother, my dear sister, again I'm fighting for time. I just say one more thing. How we deceive God? We say we love you, God. We love you, God. He asks a question, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. God said, "Yent anbarukraya, namanesikren." Without that, we gave a beautiful answer. Do you really love me? Yent anbarukraya, namanesikren. Now God said, "Nien nesikadan seiren, nesikraya." God used a different word that broke the heart of Peter. He said, "You know everything, Lord. You know everything in my life. When you are." In Pilate's chamber, I was warming up myself. I swore against you. I cursed you. You know that, Lord. When you are taken to the cross, I was far away from that. Even when John was standing by the cross, I was not standing there. You know that, Lord. When your body was hanging on the cross, there were a few women standing by the side of the cross. But I was not standing there. You know that, Lord. Can I now say I love you? Do you really love God? Do you really love God? Vire, vire, vire. Is he really your life? We are deceiving. God cannot be deceived. He is mocked at. When you could not see the body in the sepulchre, the poor woman, Mary Magdalene, was standing and weeping, I must see the body. You took no pains to find out where the body was. You just moved from that place, moved away from that place. Jesus appeared to you personally. At least twice in the upper room, Jesus appeared to you. Jesus said, go before me to Galilee. You have seen risen Savior at least thrice or minimum three times. You have seen risen Savior. You came back to Galilee. You went for fishing. You took the six people with you for fishing. You have taken back the net. You have gone back to the boat. Do you say that you love Jesus? Is that nonsense? Is that not rubbish? You can't deceive God. And the third question he broke, Jesus, you know everything, O Lord. You know everything. Somewhere, Lord, I love you also. One day, Jacob was to be broken, Peniel. In the New Testament, one day Peter was to be broken on the shores of Tiberias, on the shores of Galilee. This morning the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to you. It is not only in tithes, it is not only in offerings. In one way or the other. Are you receiving God? In your singing? In saying, I love you, Jesus. I fear you, Jesus. I honor you, Jesus. If you honor me, if I am your master, where is my honor? If I am your father, where is my respect? Don't deceive God. My dear brother, my dear sister, I share with you the points and conclude. From verse 13 to 16, verses 13 to 16, the Lord says, you burden me with your words. Just give the top, subheading, meticulously speak, carefully speak. When you talk to one to another, you are the servant of God. You are an angel of God. God is closely watching what you are talking with somebody. Somebody is bad in the sight of God and you are calling that person good. Somebody is good in the sight of God. You are calling that person bad. The words that you speak, that will be against you. I just give one illustration. I've got a lot of things to share with you. In the wilderness, God's chastisement came upon the people. God said, I am angry against you. He said one word, I listened to you, I heard you, what you are speaking in your tents. What you are speaking in your tents. The question, what tents with whom they were speaking? In their tents, husband, wife, parents, children, brothers, co-bonds. What you are talking in your tents, God is listening. You are a servant of God. You are a child of God. You are a blood-washed person. You are an angel of God. You are a holy angel or unholy angel. You are a holy angel or you are an unholy angel. What's that you are talking in your tents? What's that you are talking with your friends? What's that you are talking with other believers? What's that you are talking? God is listening when two believers are talking, two angels are talking. That decide whether they are the angels of God or they are the devils. Either you must be an angel of God or you must be a devil. You cannot say, I am neither a devil nor an angel of God. But it suggests what you talk. My dear brother, my dear sister, I just read verse 13. Your words have been stout against me, saith the Lord. Your words are heavy against me. ஒரு பாரங்கல்ல தூக்கி அவர் தலையில போட்ட மாதிரி இருக்கான். How is it in Tamil media? Your words are stout against me. அப்படியே நெஞ்சில இடிக்கிற மாதிரி இருக்குது. What is that? Yet you say, what have we spoken? So much against thee. We haven't spoken anything against thee. What's that we have spoken against? You say that in a parangala podringla, nenjila idikira maari irukudha. What's that we have spoken against thee? Yea, you have said, it is vain to serve God. Andar kumbutta enna kandan? Koyilukku poi enna kandan? Upavasam irundha enna prayojanam? You said something like this. This is throwing a boulder on God's head. ஆண்டவர் கும்பிட்டு என்ன பிரயோஜனம்? சோகம் பண்ணி என்னத்தை கண்டேன்? உபவாசம் இருந்து என்ன பிரயோஜனம்? Your words are stout against me. What is it we have said against it? You have said, it is vain to serve God. And what profit is it that we kept the ordinance? And that we have walked mournfully before the Lord of hosts. And now we call the proud happy. All those proud people, sinners, they are happy. What is the use of worshipping the Lord? You just sat and talked in your house. This is throwing a boulder on God's head. That's what the Bible says. Your words are stout against me. What's that you spoke? See, all those people, they are proud people. They are blessed. This is a stone, not a stone, a boulder that you are throwing on the head of God. It is not the Roman whip, brother. It is not the Roman whip. It is your words that pain the hearts of God. Sinners are blessed. Sinners are happy. What? God has an advice. Your words are stout against me. Speak carefully. You are a child of God. You are a servant of God. Here it says very clearly. And now we call the proud happy. Yea, that the work, that they that work wickedness are set up. They that work wickedness, their things prosper. Today, before taking the Lord's Supper, ask God to forgive you. What did you say? Those who are doing wickedness, they are set up. What is the use of me saying good, 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 obeying God in everything? Your words are stout against God. They that tempt God are even delivered. Those who are against God, they deliver, they are blessed. Then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and the book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. My dear brother, my dear sister, why unnecessarily invite curse in your life? And finally, verse 16 and 17. Verse 17. And they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. My dear brother, my dear sister, meditate on his name. Think about his name. You are a servant of God. Yahweh Yireh. Yahweh Shammah. Yahweh Shalom. El Shaddai. El Elyon. You are my provider. You are with me. You are my shepherd. You are my healer. You are almighty. You are Lord God. You are Yahweh. You change not. You are a servant of God. Don't think about your problems. Don't think about your situations. Don't think about who is for you, who is against you. If you are a servant of God, the verse 16, the latter part, it was a great strength for me, my dear brother, my dear sister, and that thought upon his name. Not thought about anything else. Not thought about my negative situations. Not thought about who is in favor of me, who is against me. Thought about thinking about his name. Thinking about his name. Chapter 3 is beautiful. Number 1, mend the way for the Lord. Number 2, made holy unto the Lord. Number 3, make a pleasant offering of your life. Number 4, meet out God's righteousness. Number 5, maintain honesty before God. Don't try to deceive God. Number 6, meticulously speak in God's presence. Every word that spells out is accounted, is written in a book. Don't speak anything that will pain the heart of the Lord. And finally, meditate upon his name. You are his. They shall be mine. And I'll spare them as his father will spare his children, his sons. God loves you. God wants to bless you. God calls you his messenger, his angel, his servant. Be worthy of this high calling. I pray for you. Dear Father God, I thank you. I praise you for this wonderful meditation from Malachi chapter 3, chapters 1, 2 and 3. Lord, we don't know what you have got in store for us in chapter 4. Every word, every line, every verse, every promise, a great blessing to us, O Lord. Lord, it's a great confidence to know that we are yours and you will spare us as a father would spare his children. You call us your gems, your treasure. Thank you, Father God. We praise you, we worship you, bless your people. In Jesus' matchless name, we pray. Amen.